It's Bleich, B-L-E-I-C-H.
And B-L-E-I-C-H?
Yep.
All right, welcome back. Looks like we're going to have Douglas Bleich first from Bureau of Land talking to us first about the hydrogeology of Penover Valley.
Penoyer Valley.
Penoyer Valley.
All right, thank you. All right, everybody hear me? Yes. All right, thank you, by the way, for having me today. This is a treat. I always enjoy hydrogeology, especially here amongst the USGS. This was a thesis project that I did with the University of Nevada, Las Vegas, and also the Desert Research Institute. And it is also a blast from the past because it was done in 1999. So bear with me. So again, this was research performed on my thesis work. And it was done for UNLV. The focus of the research area was actually the Penoyer Valley, which happened to be a groundwater divide between the Colorado Regional Flow System and also the Death Valley Regional Flow System. So in a way, it kind of harps on what Katie was talking about earlier about how the flow systems interrelate and how they're divided in this particular region. So the objective of the research, though, was to look at structural controls in the Penoyer Valley region as related to the fault zones, specifically the Penoyer Valley fault zone and then some other fault zones along the Tippecanoe Range. So again, this is just the Basin Range physiographic province. As you can see, this is a digital elevation model I pulled off the internet. But the Colorado flow system, regional flow system is here, and the Death Valley regional flow system is here. And so Penoyer Valley, the study area actually was right there. And then what I did is I combined adjacent valleys together to do a two-layer module model. So four valleys were combined. They were Penoyer, Garden, Cole, and Tickaboo valleys. They were about 140 miles northwest of Las Vegas. Penoyer Valley, colloquial, is the place where the Lele Inn is at in Rachel, Nevada. The Highway 375 goes right through. And it's north of Groom Lake. It's bounded by the Worthington Mountains on the east and the Groom Mountains on the south, the Quinn Canyon Range on the west, and let's see, also the Tippecanoe Range on the south. So what I did is I created two child models, one for the Worthington Mountains and then one for the Tippecanoe Mountains. And so we'll go over that and exactly what I did with that. So here's just another close-up of the DEM. Again, there's Penoyer Valley here, and you can kind of see the Colorado flow system here and then the Death Valley flow system here. But there's Garden, and then there's Cole, and then there's Tickaboo Valleys. And these were the four valleys here, which I combined back in 99. And this gives you a better idea of how that all related to the different regional flow systems. So this was, again, Colorado, so it's Death Valley. And this was basically digitized from my old thesis work. Now, I have to warn you, this is from 1999, so I basically took 1999 technology, took pictures of it, brought it into GIS. I see Nancy there, basically. It rubber sheeted a lot of stuff back in ArcGIS to make this work. And remarkably, it was pretty darn close considering the differences in technology and things like that. So bear with me as we go through the slides because we'll see the excellent job I did about rubber sheeting things into GIS. So the lithology, of course, is very complex, but it's simplified into quaternary alluvium, the tertiary volcanics, the asphalt tufts, and then also the welded tufts. The asphalt, of course, were more of the aquitard type layer, which was between the alluvium and the carbon rock providence area, but then also the welded tufts, which when fractured, were more transmissive. And also there's a paleozoic carbonate rocks in the Worthington Mountains and in the basement of the area. And then for structural geology, we're really looking at range bounding faults, your typical basin range type of faulting, where you have a downdrop on one side, or uplift on the other, normal faults, if you will. So the Pinoyer Springs fault is a typical basin and range normal fault. But then there are also faults along the perimeter around the edges, or the flanks rather, of the tippy range, which is much more complex than what we see in the Worthington area. And so what I did, and this was a bit time consuming, but this is the Lincoln County geology data set, and then also the southern part and the northern part of the Nye County geology data set, provided GIS from the state engineer's office. And I tried to basically take all that, import it to GIS, and then simplify it. So what you see here, of course, is the alluvium, but this is pretty much volcanics where you see brown. And then the Worthington Range here, this is carbonate. And then close to the purple here are either the lime carbonate, this is limestone or dolomite. Again, you see the four valleys here. This is the Pinoyer Garden Fold and the Tickapoo Valley. And the range bounding faults are shown here in red. This is the Pinoyer Springs Fault right here. So the regional model was constructed in this tied together all four valleys. Layer one, again, was just the quaternary alluvium, the tertiary volcanics, and where the carbonate, paleozoic carbonate, came to the surface, mostly again in the Worthington area. But then layer two was mostly volcanics and then carbonate in the basement. There's also the ash flow tuff, and the ash flow tuff in this two-layer mod flow model is simulated as an aquitard through the decant function that was in mod flow. We used a 1 square mile discretization. So the model itself had 60 columns by 115 rows, and it was calibrated at the time to the USGS flow model, which came out of Carson City. This is just an example of some of the hydraulic values I used. A lot of it was first taken from the literature, and then I tried to calibrate. And so you can see how easily this calibrated. For example, I had a model calibration of the transmissivity of 500 cubic feet per day here for the Valley Fill, but then this is from the literature. So, the median was at 1470 cubic feet per day. This was at 100 here, and this is kind of like the range. So in terms of the modeling itself, basically we tried to make things work as best we could. Again, and this was done in DOS, by the way. We had no basic GUI interface or things like that. It was just done in DOS with the post-processing in Excel to calibrate the model. And the same with the hydraulic connectivity, mostly for layer two. These are the values we got. So we, of course, developed a groundwater flow budget model. It was based off of the recharge from Max and Eakin, and then the subsurface inflow was from the literature, mostly from the state engineers' reports. I think there were some hydrologic series reports out at the time that we were looking at in terms of what was flowing between valleys and trying to make that work in terms of water flow balance. And then the outflow was evapotranspiration from the literature, subsurface outflow, and then there was some well pumpage that was down below Rachel in terms of agriculture and some alfalfa fields, I believe, at the time that were being pumped. So this was kind of an example of the flow budget. We, in general, what I had in the thesis was about 30,000 acre feet per year, as inflow, and then 30,000 acre feet as outflow. And this kind of gives you an idea of what we did with the different valleys, inflow and outflow, what the subsurface flows were modeled at. All right, so now I need to go through the exercise of my GIS and trying to reconcile what I did in 1999 with the data that I had there with GIS. So this basically is my discretized model, which I used to model the Poor Valley system in ModFlow. And what I did is I took that and rubber sheeted it into ArcGIS and superimposed it back on top of the GIS data sets we got from the State Engineer's Office and the Division of Mines and Geology. So again, this is Pryor Garden Coal at Tippecanoe Valleys, and this is the Pryor Springs Fault here. What you're seeing here is the 1 square mile discretization, and you're seeing the 60 by 115 basically superimposed back onto the geologic data set. So this was the old plate that I used back in my thesis. And what else? You just go to the next. And this was the result of the modeling itself. And so again, we were kind of focused in on this area with Pryor Valley and looking to see where it fit within the regional flow systems. And so we could clearly see from the results of the model that the flow within the garden and the Coal Valley, which sits within the Colorado River system, Colorado regional flow system, was clearly from northwest to southeast and flowing into the Colorado flow system. We speculated that there was a divide right here at the Worthington Mountains, and it turned out that the modeling sort of bore that out in a way, because right at the Worthington we saw kind of a flow divide like that, as you can see here with the arrows I had on my original plate. And then also there seemed to be flow from north to south into the Tippecanoe Valley. Tippecanoe is though designated as part of the Death Valley flow system. And so again, Pryor was not part of any of the flow systems. These two, Garden and Coal, were part of the Colorado regional flow system, and then Tippecanoe was part of the Death Valley regional flow system. So again, then you have this area right in here, which, you know, flow looks like it's kind of trending to the southwest, from the northeast to the southwest across, but it's an area that could be a groundwater mound, given what I've got in terms of these 100-foot contour elevations in the metric services here. Or it could also split and come back down this way. So at the time, it looked like in the literature there was this split right about down the middle for Pryor Valley in terms of how that related to both of the flow systems, and this seemed to bear that out a bit. Okay, so what I've got next are the child models I developed in terms of that regional flow model. So what I did is I took those two child models, the Worthington child model, that 1/8 model discretization. It was basically these rows within the Poor Valley model, 26 to 30, 26 to 40 of the columns. And then basically modeled it against the current model. I did the same with the Tippecanoe child model. It's 1/6 mile discretization, and this corresponds to the rows and the columns of the Poor Valley model. So each model simulated either no faults, which was basically general head boundary calibration to the Poor Valley model, or it simulated high transmissivity fault zones or low transmissivity fault zones. And so what we meant by that is we had no idea basically what was going on in terms of, are the faults affecting transmission from one valley to the next or not? So what we did is we took extremes, basically we tested, let's just go ahead and discretize the fault zones, let's apply low transmissivities and high transmissivities to the fault zones, and just to see what the results gave us. So again, the rubber sheeting works really great right there. There's the Burlington Mountain child model, and this is the Tippecanoe child model. So again, we're looking at the Pryor Garden Coal and Tippecanoe Valley here, but these are the child models that we did in the thesis. And what I'm really thrilled about is after doing this in 1999 and then checking the GIS data set, this is the Pryor Valley this is the Pinoyer Valley Fault System right here. It looks like it's reasonably close to Pervade right there. So I was like, wow, this is great. I did this in 1999. I did some digital fault zone here that came close to the GIS data sets once I finally georeferenced it inside GIS everything. So, because this was all done basically manually back in 99 with what I had. And this was, I think, really done in Excel at the time. So the Tempe Ute child model was just a bit more complex. There was the Pinoyer Springs fault, which is here, and then there is the Range Mountain fault here. There was other faults here and here. So I tried to get them all. I think this is the Schofield Pass fault. Yeah, this is the Tickapoo Valley fault here. And then there was a Range Valley fault not coming up on our current GIS data sets, which was on the Garden Valley side, blocking out the Worthington Mountains. Okay. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to step through the results of the child modeling, so to speak, with the low transmissivity and the high transmissivity fault zone. So this was, again, the result from the thesis work, which was the Worthington result. It was calibrated against the Four Valley model. It just kind of shows what that looked like and then rerun with the smaller discretization. And then this was the high transmissivity result of that, showing what might happen if we had highly transmissive fault zones and what the model results might look like. And this is the low transmissivity results, kind of a higher flow. But in general, the flow was ultimately in the same direction, either north to south, or it did get through. It's just that, of course, the transmissivity would affect time or the velocity or the overall transmissive distribution of the flow and things like that. All right, so this was the Tempe Ute child model results here again. This was the discretization. And this was calibrating to general head boundaries to the Four Valley model. This was the next was the high transmissivity, which is interesting here. Again, here's the Pinoyer Valley fault zone here. You kind of see that some of the flow and the high transmissivity was certainly following the fault line here. And then the flow still, even with the high transmissivity and the low transmissivity, made its way from north to south into the Tickapoo Valley. And then this was the high transmissivity, or low transmissivity rather, results of the So again, still flowing from north to south, but it's just taking more time. It's more of a turned out with an impediment there, but it didn't really stop flow altogether from transmitting from one valley to the next. I think my time's up at this point. So anyway, regional, you know, there is still the flow that occurred that we saw from a regional basis from one valley to the next. It looks like that the Pinoyer Valley does contribute maybe to both flow regimes, like we talked about. It looks like the Worthington Mountains do form a barrier between the two flow regimes. And you know what? This thing really needs updating. So yeah, in the future, it might be something else that we can develop with this and the results and bring it up to speed.
So, thanks for bringing that.
Glad to try and take questions, sir.
Well, you're sure that the ET discharge from Pinoyer was touched more than 12,000 acre feet a year. And I just went and looked at Jim Harrell's publication from the 80s, and the estimate was 4,300 acre feet per year. And that was the basis of the conceptual model of the Great Basin RAS that you used.
That's correct, yes.
So
what's the
got
difference?
A major chunk of discharge, but
yes.
Conceptualized it as
what I did is I lumped in the well discharge for the wells that were below the south of Rachel into the ET on that. So
okay.
that's that discrepancy, and I should have pointed that out. I
right.
Also should have pointed out this is just a kind of an overview of the whole thesis. I have my thesis back there. I can show you, go into the details on that. For those who really want to get in there.
I saw that number and it triggered.
Yeah, no problem. That I almost knew that was going to come up, so I
Any other questions? All right.
Thank you, Douglas.
Thank you so much.
Oh, I need kids, Cage.
You need it.
Keep going.
All right. So next we have Wayne Belcher.